Hey, I'm Bill Jelen from MrExcel.com, and I've got a cool Excel tip for you today.
Hey, this is Mike Girvin, and Excel is fun on YouTube, and I have a different way to do that.
Hey, welcome back. It's another Dueling Excel podcast. I'm Bill Jelen from Mr. Excel. Today we have a question sent in by YouTube. Someone has a range of data and they'd like to invert that range. In other words, the last cell becomes the first cell and the first cell becomes the last cell. Now, I'm going to do this with a formula. I'm going to come over here and create a new range called inverted, and I want to figure out how many rows I have in the original data set. So I'm going to use Control Shift down arrow to select that, and we see up here that it's 24 rows. Now, if you go further, it's going to become a tooltip down here at the bottom, so you can see how many rows. But we have 24 rows. Need to know that number, and I'm going to build a formula here of equal index. The index function can handle an array. In this case, it's a vector array, and we just have to pass it the row number that we want. So I'm going to say the index of this original range. I press the F4 key to lock that down, and then I want 25 minus. In this case, I want 25 minus 1, but I'm not going to put a 1 there. That would be horrible. I would have to copy that over. So I'm going to ask for the row of A1. Row of A1 being a very geeky way to write the number 1. We'll press Enter, and the first test we get is the last item down here, X29, becomes the first item up here. Now let's copy that formula down, and you see that it goes in order. Second to the last item, W28, becomes W28. B21. And the great thing about this is it is live. So if we would sort this the other way, let's go here to data and click sort descending. You see that my list, the formula here, becomes absolutely inverted, including the product in the wrong spot. So that's my formula method. Let's throw it over to Mike and see what Mike from Excel is Fun has for a solution.
Thanks, Mr. Excel. Now, that was a great formula here. And I have to tell you, if that row is geeky, I'm going to do something that's even geekier. Hey, I'm going to click right here, and I'm going to use the same index. Index is such a versatile, amazing function. And I'm going to get the same array. I'll click right there, Control Shift Down Arrow, and then F4 to lock it going down. There's the array, comma, and now we need a row number. Now, I'm going to use the rows function, right? So that's at least one S geekier than row. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight this whole range here, Control Shift Down Arrow. And I don't want to F4 because I want one of them relative. This one is going to be relative, but I'm going to lock this one. So I'll hit the F4 key, lock it in front of the row reference. And what this does, A26 is locked, but A3 is not. So as we copy it down, right now it's going to give us 24 rows, 3, including 3 all the way to 26 is 24. But when it gets down to the next row, this A3 will become A4, so it will be one less rows. So rows counts all the rows, whereas the row function counts just a particular row. I'm going to close parentheses. And by the way, I have to give credit to Dukes of Scouts, the comment section at the Excel is Fun site for this formula. Control Enter, and then I'm going to drag it down. And just like that, we get the same inverted range. Let's take a look here. See how this one went to A4 to A26, so now it's counting one fewer rows. Both this formula, this little construction here, and this one right here gives us 24, 23, 22, 21. Not only that, but if you were going to do this to the side, so here's Mr. Excel's formula. You use the column function, A1. And if you're going to use this one, you use the columns. Because since we're copying across columns, we need to count or find out what column we're in. All right, we'll see you next trick.
Mike, that's brilliant. Rows instead of row. A great improvement because then you don't have to hard code the number of cells in the range. And also, first time I've ever really thought about using a relative as the top cell and absolute as the bottom cell. Now, I've done the opposite all the time when I'm creating a running total, but this was just gorgeous. Point for Mike. Hey, everyone out there, thanks for stopping by on behalf of Mike and myself. We'll see you next time for another Dueling podcast from Mr. Excel, and Excel is Fun.